The Arch Gaming Network is proud to bring you this board game review. Now here's your host, Sean Smith.
Howdy, mateys. Shiver me timbers. Today we're taking a look at the game Dark Seas.
I want to sincerely apologize to everyone in the pirate community for that offensive and highly stereotypical pirate-themed intro. It was inappropriate, and I truly am sorry. For the rest of you who had to endure it, I am even more sorry. Dark Seas was published by Anthony Rubbo and published by AEG. Now, in Dark Seas, it is a 2-4 player game where you will be taking on the role of a pirate, building up an island, having you and your ship visit various ports, plundering, recruiting pirates, trying to gain treasure chests, all in the hopes of being the most infamous pirate at the end of the game. Now, this game features dice rolling as one of its main mechanics, but it also has some tile laying, it has some take that to it, and it has also kind of an engine building component to it as well. So why don't we take a look at the setup walkthrough, and then I'll give you my thoughts on the other side. Okay, to set up Dark Seas, each player is going to get a center tile. This is your center island tile, and your player color is denoted by the background here. They're all the same, just the color is different. You're going to place that in the center of your play area. Then you have port tiles, and there are 6 different colors. Now, there really isn't a whole lot to placing these. You do need to take the port of your color, and using the gold at the top, you will have that facing the center of the table so that all players know what color you are. As far as the rest of these, you can place them anywhere you want. The only restriction is that this gold here has to be touching the gold center of the center island tile. Each player is then going to get these 2 tiles. They're the barkeep and the dive bar. You can find them easily because they have a black background and they say starting tile. The dive bar is going to go at the 6 o'clock position and the barkeep will go at the 2 o'clock position. You then have your captain, place him on the center island. You have your ship, place him at the lowest port. Each player is then going to get 3 doubloons. That's your cash in the game. Each player will get 1 treasure chest, which has treasure inside of it on the other side. You're trying to collect sets of these. You have your pirates over here. You have your regular pirates and your dread pirates. I'll tell you the difference about those in a minute. You just place those off to the side. You have your doubloons off to the side. You have your ones and some worth 3. All the treasure chests will be face down. You have 5 dice, but you're just going to put 4 in the center, and then you'll just leave the other one off to the side. Each player now is going to take 4 of these plunder cards. You have all these plunder cards, and these cards can be used to set around your island, or you can use them during the scheming phase that we'll talk about in a moment. Yeah, shuffle those up and just make a few piles, and each player will take 4 of them. They will decide which one they want to keep and place that at the kind of the 10 o'clock position. Then they're going to discard one. And then they'll keep the other two face down in their hand. Finally, you have your player, the board. This has the infamy tracker on it. Keeps track of the 12 rounds of the game. It also has some shortcuts on how the rounds go. So you're just gonna set that off to the side. You put the round token on round one. Each of the player's infamy track tokens will go on zero. And now you're ready to play. Okay, we're set up for a two-player game, but we're just gonna focus in on the green player's board here. Now the object of the game is to have the most infamy at the end of the game. In order to gain infamy, you can do that through some of these plunder tiles. And we'll talk more about those in a moment. But you're going to be collecting treasures, trying to collect doubloons, recruit pirates, and all of these things can help you gain infamy at the end of the game. You can certainly get infamy during the game, but there's also a lot of infamy points that you can get at the end. So real quickly, the board is divided into a few sections. One, you have your center hex tile, and then you have your port hexes, and then you have the plunder that are attached to the various ports. The starting player is going to roll all four dice, okay? Let's say that is the roll. The starting player can now decide to re-roll any or all of the dice. However, I like this roll, so I think I'm going to keep it. I need to point something out real quick regarding the dice. For this tutorial, you need to be aware that during the production of the game, there was a mistake made. You have these colors and icons, and they are supposed to match the colors and the icons that are on these tiles. But as you can see, we can get that focus there. This is kind of a target symbol, whereas the green here has kind of some sword symbols on it. Three of the colors do not match. So the purple has a treasure chest on it, while the purple tile kind of has what looks like a squid or...
Whatever.
Jellyfish, that's what I was looking for. So for the purposes of the tutorial, it's important to note you only need to play with the colors. You can ignore the symbols on these dice and the game will play just the same. So after the starting player has rolled, and if he wanted to re-rolled, you move on to the scheme with plunder tiles. So the starting player will look at the plunder tiles that are in his hand. Okay, not the ones that are on the board. You can now scheme with these tiles. Now, for the purposes of scheming, and you might not be able to see it, but there is a horizontal line here. When you're scheming, you're just looking at the color and the black icon that's next to it, and you're ignoring any of the words on here. When you decide to scheme, you will, in effect, discard this from your hand to gain that particular item. So in this case, you could discard it to get a doubloon. There are three types of these scheme tiles. So you can discard this tile to recruit a pirate anywhere on the board. You can discard this tile to gain a doubloon. And you can discard this tile to gain one treasure chest. So to be able to scheme, the tile color has to match at least one of the dice that you rolled. So I have two tiles that I could scheme with. I don't have to, but if I wanted to, I could turn one of these in because there's only one black die. So I can only activate one of these two cards. You know what? I'm going to go ahead and recruit a pirate. So I am going to discard this to a discard pile. Now I also have this card for a red. I could gain a treasure chest as well. Okay, so you know what? I think I'm gonna do that one too. So I discard it and I'll take a treasure chest at random. I keep it a secret, I can look at it. but then I'll place it with my other treasure chest. The more of these symbols that I can match on the back, the more points they'll be worth at the end of the game. Now, one of the scheming tiles was for me to recruit a pirate. So that means I could take a regular pirate and place them on any one of these squares. Now, you'll notice these squares, or I'm sorry, these ports have four squares on them. Each port tile can hold four pirates, okay? When you're recruiting, you can just place them right on the tile. However, when you recruit, you can pay one doubloon, which I'll do, to make him a dread pirate. Now, dread pirates and regular pirates act the same during the game. There's no difference. However, at the end of the game, you get additional scoring for each dread pirate that you have. Okay, after you've done your scheming, you now can move your captain. Now your captain can move to any adjacent tile from the center tile or move from one port to the next. Anytime you move your captain into the center tile, you'll get to do that action, which is to draw two plunder tiles, keep one and discard the other, or gain one doubloon. You don't have to move your pirate. So if you decide to just leave your pirate here, then you can take this action. So why would you want to move your captain anyway? Well, I'm glad you asked, because we're going to move our captain here, and you'll see why in just a moment. After you've moved your captain, or not moved him if you didn't want to, it's now time to move your ship and resolve plunder tiles. Your ship can move along all the ports one space at a time in clockwise fashion. To move to the next space that is clockwise, you have to have rolled the die that would allow you to move to that space. So since I rolled a black, I could move to this black one. Now, if this tile had any plunder tiles, if I had a plunder tile here, I could then resolve that particular plunder tile. There's not one. Now I want to move to blue, but I hadn't rolled a blue. Because I had moved my captain here, that allows your ship to move through to that tile. If the captain wasn't there, I wouldn't have been able to move to blue, and my movement basically would have been over. So moving your captain kind of is like if you had rolled a die of that color. Now I can do the plunder that is attached to that. Now let's take a look at the tiles here. As you can see, these tiles have a bay area. Now you can only do plunder tiles that are attached to that bay area. So if, for example, this is connected to the blue tile, this would not be connected to blue because it doesn't touch the bay area. It's connected to the black one. So I can now do this action. This says gain one doubloon and gain one infamy. So I will take a doubloon from the pile here, place that there, and then move my token up one space on the infamy track. But I'm not done. I rolled a green, and green is next, so I can now move my ship to green. There's nothing here to do. I don't have any plunder tiles. Now, I could stay here. In fact, I can stay on any tile that I want to. I don't have to move to the various tiles. It's up to me if I want to do that. It's important to note, your ship must move to be able to execute a plunder tile. So, starting back at here, if I decided I didn't want to move, I can't just do this plunder tile. I have to move to activate that. Since I've rolled a red, I do want to move on to here, and now I can do this action, which is draw one plunder tile and gain one infamy. So I'll just take one at random from the draw pile. All right. Scheming action, I can get a doubloon if I turn it in for a blue die, or I can play it as a plunder tile and gain one doubloon per pirate here. I'll just put that in my stock here, and now I have purple. Again, I don't have to move from red, but I'm going to move to purple. And now my movement is done. I can't move anymore. I don't have a yellow to move to. So as far as my ship movement is concerned, it is completed. All right. So now I can place a plunder tile if I want. So I have these two plunder tiles, and I think this one says you must have two pirates here to place this, and then at the end of the game you gain 4 infamy. Well, I don't have two pirates there, so I can't really play that one. I do think I'll play this one, which is gain 1 doubloon per pirate here. So, making sure that I connect it to the bay for that particular tile. You can only place a plunder tile where your ship is. The other one just goes right back into my stock. Now that is the end of the green player's turn. Now the red player will take his turn using these colors. Since the other players must use these colors, it can sometimes cause them to get stuck or not be able to scheme or place plunder tiles where they want. So you can kind of keep an eye sometimes on what other players might be doing or where they might want to go, and then maybe make sure you're not rolling that particular color to get them to where they want to go. After all players have gone through all of the steps, you're then going to pass the dice to the next player. And you're going to start again. That player will roll the dice, re-roll, and then all the players have to use those dice for that round. Now, a couple things to note. There is a fifth die in here. Sometimes these plunder tiles will tell you to roll. When that occurs, you're rolling this fifth die. That's the only time that that will come into use. Also, if the plunder tiles run out, just shuffle up the discard and create some new piles. And just keep in mind, you can never have more than 4 pirates on a port. Okay, after all players have used the dice for a round, you're going to move the round tracker to the next one. You're going to do this for 12 rounds. And at the end of the 12th round, the game will end. However, there is now the end of game scoring. The first thing you're going to look at is the wealth. So your players will gain infamy based on the quantity of matching treasures you have collected during the game. Now, and I have 2 treasures here, and they don't match, so they're only worth 1 infamy apiece. If I had a set of 2 matching, there were 3. 3 of them are worth 6, and 4 are worth 10 points. And then you're also going to gain 1 infamy for every 3 doubloons that you have left over at the end of the game, so that would be worth 1 infamy. Then you're going to score infamy points based on the power. So for every dread pirate that you have, you're going to gain 1 infamy. For every port tile that you have at least 1 pirate on it, you're going to get 1 infamy. For every port that you have 4 pirates on it, you're going to get 1 infamy. And then if you have any tiles, plunder tiles out here that give you end of game scoring, you'll then add those if those are applicable. The one who has the most infamy is the winner of the game. Okay, I want to start off by saying that I really do enjoy playing this game. Unfortunately, there are some things about the production of the game that need to be addressed. Of course, first and foremost are the incorrect dice. You know, for example, on this card here, the yellow has a hook symbol, but on the die, it's the symbol of doubloons, and 3 sides of the dice have an incorrect icon on that, and that's unfortunate. Now, AEG has a link on their site. If your game came with the wrong set of dice, you can request a new set. I have done that. I did it recently, so I haven't received them yet, but I think it was nice that they have admitted their mistake, that there was a problem during production, they got it wrong, and that they're willing to ship those out for free. Aside from that, the dice are good quality though. The colors are good on them. They're solid. They have kind of an embossed the icons on there. So I really think they did a good job with the dice. Unfortunate that there was a mix-up with them. Now, regarding the like the port tiles that you have here, the ones with the spaces for the pirates, I wish that they would have made these tiles maybe a half an inch bigger. The footprint for your island isn't that big. You couldn't have made the tiles a little bit bigger, even in a four-player game. I think you would have had plenty of room. The problem that I have with these tiles is that they're too small. When you have four pirates, your ship, and your captain on that, it gets pretty crowded on there, and I think they would have benefited from making these tiles a little bit bigger, and then the wordings a little bit bigger on them as well. However, the tiles themselves, I think, are a decent quality, and I do like the artwork on these tiles. I think they did a really good job with that. Now, as far as some of the other components, the doubloons, the single doubloons here, I don't know if you can see that, if that'll zoom in, but I have no idea what that symbol is. I am not sure what they were trying to go for there. I don't get it. The ones that are three have a three on them. These don't have anything on them. But, you know, I guess that's not that important. The fact that, and you may not even be able to see it, but, you know, the edges start to kind of curl up on them. I don't know. They're just okay. The treasure chests are kind of the same way. They're just okay. Now, your pirate, and I'm sorry, your captain and your ship. I think these are really good, nice wooden, good, you know, shape and design to them. They do tend to fall over, especially the captain a little bit. But maybe that's just me being clumsy.
Correct.
Uh-huh. When it comes to the round marker and the infamy track, you know, they kind of went with pirate or a treasure chest map color scheme and theme to it, and I really don't have an issue with that. However, this the track that you keep for the track of the infamy points, the squares are too small because they give you, you know, these tokens here. Well, you can see the token is taking up more space than what you have. And so when you have, you know, several players grouped together, it gets very crowded on this track. I wish they would have made the track a little bit bigger, or maybe used, you know, smaller, maybe some squares of different colors. It's something that, to me, it feels like maybe the production was a little rushed on the game. And I think that's unfortunate because I like I said earlier, the game for me is a lot of fun. It hits on a lot of mechanics that I enjoy. The dice rolling, to take that, which, you know, is a little bit of the game, but not a lot. Trying to build that engine, those plunder tiles around your island, having to decide, you know, are you going to scheme? Are you going to set new plunder tiles down? Having to take care and watch your resources, your doubloons that you have, and just trying to set yourself up to have kind of a good shot at the end of the game when you take on all that additional scoring. There's a lot of meat packed into this game, but it plays light. It's a light strategy, and it's easy to teach. So, like I said, I really do enjoy the game. The gameplay will seem to feel like you are playing a solitaire game with other people, in that you really are mostly focusing on your island, setting up your engine and getting around and gaining those infamy and recruiting those pirates, not really having to pay too much attention to the other players. But you certainly can, because that rolling mechanism, you can at least look at other players and see if a roll that you just did keeps them from moving or moving very far around the board. So there is a little bit to that, but for the most part, you really are just kind of concentrating on your own island. I think the theme of the game works well. The pirating theme with the various actions that you have to do tie really well into it. Again, aside from the production value, it is a really fun game to play. So I would like to rate this game a little bit higher, but the production does knock it down a notch. I still give it a 7. It's a good game. If you like the pirate theme or you like the kind of mechanics that are in this game, I really do think you'll enjoy it. So if you like this review, please leave a like below, subscribe to our channel, and check out our other great videos. Once again, thank you for stopping by.
Thank you for visiting the Arch Gaming Network. For more great content, check us out at archgamingnetwork.com. Subscribe to our YouTube channel. Follow us on Twitter and like us on Facebook.